As long as there have been sports, there have been athletes in search of an advantage. And of all of the ways to get a leg up, these days professionals often turn to performance-enhancing drugs. You hear about them in just about every sport. In the US, some of the best baseball players of all time have been accused of using PEDs. American football players are regularly suspended for failing drug tests. And of course, Lance Armstrong famously finally came clean about blood doping in 2012, vacating his 7 Tour de France victories in the process. And then there's the whole deer antler spray thing. There's no shortage of ways athletes try to enhance their performance. Some of them work, but at high cost to their health or wealth, and others just don't work at all. So, which are which, and how do they work and not work? Give me a few minutes, and I'll give you a few lessons in the science of why cheaters never win. We refer to them as drugs, but most performance enhancers are really just versions of the chemicals that you already have in your body. These are the compounds that your body uses to build and heal itself and keep itself healthy. But by ramping up the levels of these compounds in the hopes of getting more out of your body, you could end up putting yourself in a world of hurt. HGH, or human growth hormone, is a good place to start. Even though we all have it, a lot of people have no idea what it is. Your body produces HGH from the pituitary gland at the base of your brain. It stimulates growth and cell development, and it works with another hormone called insulin-like growth factor 1, also known as IGF-1. HGH is converted into IGF-1 in the liver, and it has several effects throughout the body, including increasing bone and muscle growth. The natural production of HGH peaks during your teenage years, starts to steadily decrease about the time you hit 30, and declines through the rest of your life. Growth hormone does help regulate metabolism in adults, but its main purpose is really to spur growth during childhood. Since 1985, an injectable form of HGH has been produced synthetically, and the US Food and Drug Administration approved it to treat children with growth issues, genetic disorders, and kidney problems. For adults, HGH might be prescribed for conditions like bone loss or high cholesterol or very rare pituitary tumors. Despite its high cost, a month's supply of HGH can cost up to $5,000, human growth hormone has become popular among athletes looking for an edge. A big reason for this is that it is really hard to detect since everyone's body produces it. Also, HGH starts to break down within 30 minutes of injection, so even the best tests can only detect it, like through abnormally high levels of certain antibodies in the blood within 12 to 24 hours. But here's the thing. For all the athletes and dozens of sports who take HGH, there's actually very little evidence that it provides any performance enhancement. HGH may stimulate muscle and bone growth, but whether that translates into increased power, strength, or endurance is unclear. Researchers in California recently conducted a review of 44 studies of growth hormone in athletes. More than 300 volunteers in all these studies combined received injections of growth hormone for an average of 20 days, similar to a drug cycle that an elite athlete might use. While those who received the HGH instead of a placebo did increase their lean body mass by over 2 kilograms, there was no measurable increase in either their strength or their exercise capacity. There has been all of one study that reported a positive effect of growth hormone on athletic performance. At the University of Queensland in Australia, scientists in 2010 studied 103 recreational athletes and found that while those taking HGH showed no improvement in strength or general fitness, their sprinting times on a bicycle improved by 4%. That's all. Not a huge difference. But in a competitive event, 4% could represent the difference between winning the gold and finishing last. What several of the studies did find, and what anti-doping agencies have discovered, is that the performance does improve when HGH is used with testosterone. And do you know what they call synthetic derivatives of the hormone testosterone? If you said anabolic steroid, then you win a gold medal of your own. We've talked about steroids before, but it's kind of impossible to talk about performance enhancers without touching on them again. Steroids are a kind of lipid or fat molecule, and your body makes two very different types. One kind you might be familiar with are corticosteroids. They're hormones produced by your adrenal glands down there on your kidneys, and they're handy at things like immune function, stress response, and controlling inflammation. You may have been prescribed medications that are synthetic versions of these steroids to treat joint injuries or an autoimmune disease or just really bad poison ivy rash, which is why I took it. The other kind of steroids are androgenic anabolic steroids. The main one of these is testosterone, which, as you know, produces male sex characteristics. But these steroids also include compounds that stimulate the synthesis of proteins and eventually new muscle fibers. This process is called anabolism, and the steroids that drive it are anabolic steroids. When synthetic versions of these bad boys are used illegally by athletes, actually abused might be the better term here, the combination of steroids and exercise can increase a man's strength by more than 38%, and it's at least that high for women. Anabolic steroids can be freakishly efficient, especially when the user takes more than one. Doping athletes generally take steroids in cycles lasting between 1 and 3 months when strength training in the off-season. This is also when they're less likely to get tested. When injected or swallowed, these steroids travel to muscle tissue where they attach to receptors on the membranes of muscle cells. The receptors deliver the steroid hormones to the nucleus of the cells where they stimulate anabolism, the synthesis of proteins. But anabolic steroids also carry with them some crazy side effects. Not only do raised testosterone levels often lead to increased aggression and sex drive, but they can also, strangely enough, lead to shrinking testicles, impotence, and heart damage. In women, steroids can cause facial hair growth, acne, liver damage, breast reduction, and changes to or total stopping of the menstrual cycle. Not that you are wondering, but I can assure you that this body is completely steroid-free. I mean, do I have to list the side effects again? Don't do that. Also, if you're more into aerobic activities, especially competitive bicycle racing, can I suggest that you not partake in blood doping? Bicyclists and other endurance athletes will often use anabolic steroids, but blood doping is becoming more and more common, in large part because it's harder to detect. This kind of doping generally works in one of two ways, either through direct blood transfusions, in many cases athletes use their own blood, or through injections of a synthetic form of erythropoietin, or EPO, a hormone that controls your body's production of red blood cells. In both cases, the goal is the same, to increase the number of red blood cells in the body to increase physical stamina. Red blood cells use a protein called hemoglobin to bind with oxygen and deliver it throughout your body. Since your body uses up to 20 times more oxygen during strenuous exercise than while resting, if you can raise your red blood cell count by having more blood, or with EPO, your tissues can keep getting the oxygen they need and you can keep cycling or whatever for a lot longer. And before you know it, you've won the world's most famous bicycle race! By cheating! The dangerous world of PEDs is of course not limited to HGH, steroids, and blood doping. The longer you look, the stranger the stories you will hear of athletes attempting to get an edge. This includes baseball player Manny Ramirez, who in 2009 was suspended for 50 games after testing positive for human chorionic gonadotropin, a hormone that women produce during pregnancy. Turns out, it also boosts testosterone levels in men and can increase sperm production. Ironically, many steroid users take HCG after developing fertility problems. PEDs also aren't limited to sports where the competitors aim to be stronger or faster. In 2008, a member of the North Korean Olympic team was stripped of 2 medals after testing positive for propranolol. Propranolol is a drug used to treat hypertension and prevent trembling. The sport in question? Shooting. Similar PED use is also a problem in the archery world, where shaky hands can lead to poor performance. And then there's deer antler spray, a PED that you probably didn't know existed until 2012. That's when NFL player Ray Lewis admitted to using the stuff in the hopes of speeding his recovery after tearing a bicep. The velvety tissue on young deer antlers contains high levels of growth hormone IGF-1 that I mentioned earlier. This is partly what makes antlers grow so quickly. Some companies claim that they can extract this hormone from the tissue and then put it in a spray that can be administered under the tongue. You will no doubt be shocked to hear that there's no evidence that IGF-1 can be successfully delivered in a pill or spray form, even if the hormone comes from the antlers of some super deer in New Zealand. And yet, deer antler spray has fast become one of the more popular supplements on the market. So here's my advice to all the athletes out there. If the choice is between injecting yourself with synthetic testosterone that makes you sterile and unable to have sex, changing the amount of blood you have in your body, or buying some crazy concoction supposedly made from a deer's head and putting it under your tongue, I recommend choosing none of the above. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow, and extra special thanks to our subbable supporters, without whom we could not do this. If you have any questions or comments or ideas for us, we're down in the comments below or on Facebook and Twitter. And if you want to keep getting smarter with us, you can go to youtube.com/SciShow and subscribe.